introduce myself, Pinky Singh, Assistant Professor of IMS Law College, Noida. And today I will discuss with you a very important subject in law courses, that is the professional ethics, accountancy of lawyers and bar bench relationship. This is the name of the subject, and under this I supposed to tell you about the history of legal profession in India. As the legal profession, it is an important limb of the machinery for administration of justice, and without a well-organized profession of law, the courts would not be in a position to administer justice effectively. Now, in legal profession, what is the very important thing? Important is the ethics. Ethics which deals in every profession, like in this subject particularly, professional ethics. And what is the meaning of this ethics? This particular word ethics is derived from the Greek word ethos. Ethos means character. And the Latin words mores. Mores means custom. And together they combine to define how individual choose to interact with one other. And in philosophy, ethics define what is good for the individual and for the societies. Because as by the Lord Atkin said that the legal profession is a para-public institution which deserves the special confidence of and owes greater responsibility to the community at large than the ordinary run of agency. The fundamental of this legal ethics or ethics of the legal profession to secure a spirit of friendly cooperation between bench and bar in the promotion of highest standard of justice, to establish honorable and fair dealings of the counsel with his client's opponent and witness, to establish a spirit of brotherhood with the bar. Lawyers are the key functionaries assisting the judges in the administration of justice. And a well-organized system of judicial administration postulates a properly equipped and efficient bar. And we will divide the development of legal profession of India in four heads. We can say that first era is the legal profession in ancient India. Second is the legal profession in medieval India. And third is the legal profession in British India. And last is the legal profession in India after the independence. So first one, legal profession in ancient India. As this history of legal profession in India is a history of struggle. A struggle for recognition characterized by prestige, power and income. So, first one, this legal profession in ancient India. In India, during the earlier period when people lived in small groups, and these groups was headed by some, we can say, a group leader, or there are some heads who deliver justice under the open sky before all the members, and they made the open argument. There were no specialists like a lawyer during those days. And when kingship was established in the society, kings delivered the justice. In the king's court, and the king was advised by his counselors. The particular law on those days was rooted in Hindu religion and custom. Dharma was protected by the king. Though there was no institution of a lawyer, some intellectual people served justice. For some time, religious heads dominated the society in administering the justice. And during those days, the sufferer presented complaint before the king in his court. And thereafter, the court summoned the defendant to submit his reply. So this is the procedure which we followed in the ancient India when no particular system of law or any institution was established. The court then investigated the matter on the evidence. The king took the advice of the religious heads and wise courtiers and then delivered the judgment. And this particular same procedure was followed in all the cases. Next is the legal profession in medieval India. During the Muslims period, there was no particular institution of legal profession which was particularly established at the Muslim era. But both the parties of the litigation appoints their wakil. They have a right to appoint the wakil, and this body decide the case, and they were paid a percentage of the amount in the suit. And court has the power to decide who should be allowed to appear as wakil. They act as agent for principals but not as lawyers. And this same system was continued in North India even under the rule of East India Company. Legal profession in British India. During the British period, the modern legal system was developed in India. Before 1726, the courts derived their power not from the British Crown but from the East India Company. There was particularly some charters was made at that time. First one is the Charter of 1726. In this particular charter, the Crown issued the Charter of 1726, and the Mayor's Court were established in the Presidency towns of Bombay, Calcutta and Madras. They were the Royal Courts and they followed the procedure which is based on the English law. But there were no facilities to get the legal training. Many persons who have no knowledge of law were used to practice before the SAT courts. The Mayor's Court has no jurisdiction in criminal cases. The criminal jurisdiction was conferred on the governor. After that Charter of 1753 came, and it was issued to modify the Charter of 1726. After 1753 charter came and it modified the Charter of 1726. This charter also ignored some significant provisions for legal training and education which is relating to the legal practitioner. And even after this particular charter of 1753, our legal profession was not organized fully. After this, Charter of 1774 came, and this particular charter which established the Supreme Court. This was the first real step in the direction of organizing a legal profession in India. This particular charter empowered the British government or crown to establish a Supreme Court. And accordingly, a Supreme Court at Calcutta was established. This particular charter empowered the said Supreme Court of Judicature Calcutta to approve and enroll an attorneys in law. This particular charter empowered the Supreme Court to approve, admit and enroll so many advocates and attorneys at law as it thought proper. They were to be the attorneys of record and they were authorized to appear and act in the Supreme Court. And this particular Supreme Court had the power to remove any advocate or any attorneys on reasonable clause. Indian legal practitioners were not allowed to appear or enter the Supreme Court. At that particular time, advocate means only the British and Irish barristers and members of the faculty of advocates in Scotland. The term attorney applied to the British attorneys or solicitors. However, only Englishmen and no Indian had the right to appear before the court. After that, the Bengal Regulation Act of 1793 appeared. This particular act permitted and qualified the Hindu and Muslim persons only to enroll as pleaders. And the Bengal Regulation 12 of 1833 allowed all the qualified persons of any nationality or religion to enroll as a pleader of the Sardar Diwani Adalat. After that, Indian High Court Act 1861, this particular High Court created in place of the Supreme Courts and Sardar Adalats, and they were authorized to approve, admit and enroll advocates, vakils and attorneys. They were entitled to appear for the suitors of the High Court and to plead or act according to rules made by the High Court or directions issued by it. The criminal courts were organized by the Criminal Procedure Code 1898. And after that, Legal Practitioner Act 1879 enact. This particular act was enacted to consolidate and amend the law relating to legal practitioners of the High Court. It also empowered the High Court, not established under a royal charter, to make rules with the previous sanction of the provincial government as to the qualifications and admissions of the proper persons to be appears and muktars of the subordinate courts. All these were brought under the jurisdiction of the High Courts. Vakils were the persons who had taken the law degree from the Indian universities. Pleaders and muktars were the Indian advocates, lawyers, but advocates were to be the barristers. After that, Indian Bar Committee 1923 came. This particular committee, or committee called Indian Bar Committee, under the chairmanship of Sir Edward Cammier. It was constituted in 1923 to consider the issue of the organization of the bar on all India basis. The committee did not favor the establishment of All India Bar Council, but it was of the view that the Bar Council should be constituted for the each High Court, and they were also a demand. There was also a demand for creating an All India Bar in the country. After that, Indian Bar Council Act 1926 was came. This particular act was came after the report of the Cammier Committee. This particular Indian Bar Council of India Act was enacted to provide a bar council for each High Court. The Bombay High Court and the Calcutta High Court allowed non-barrister advocates to practice. Thus, the distinction between barrister and advocates were abolished. The pleaders and muktars practicing in Mufsil's court were not within the scope of the Indian Bar Council Act of 1926. Thus, this particular act did not achieve what it was desired. The Bar Councils were the simply advisory bodies, and the real powers, means the enrollment of advocates and the disciplinary jurisdiction, it was vested in the High Courts. So the councils were neither the autonomous nor had any substantial authority, nor it made any provisions with respect to the legal practitioners in the subordinate courts. The difficulties regarding the practice by an advocate of one of the High Court in another High Court were not removed because the rules differed from High Court to High Court. And after the independence era, when we were independent, the All India Bar Committee 1951, this was came, and because this particular bar was not satisfied with the passing of the Bar Council Act of 1926, so the act had not covered the pleaders, muktars and revenue agents who practicing in the Mufsil's courts and revenue offices, and consequently did not set up a unified Indian bar. So the committee in its report recommended the establishment of an All India Bar Councils and State Bar Councils. It recommended the powers of enrollment, suspension or the removal of advocates to the Bar Council. It also recommended the common rule. This particular committee also recommended the common rules of advocate, and it should be maintained, and they should be authorized to practice in all courts in the country. It further recommended that there should be no further recruitment of non-graduated pleaders or muktars. The committee recommended the creation of All India Bar Council with the common role of all advocates, and also the bar councils for states with larger autonomy. But it did not felt the need for a separate bar council for the Supreme Court. and these particular similar recommendations were made by the 5th Law Commission of India in its 14th report. After this, the Advocate Act 1961 was came, and this particular act was a milestone for the advocates, because this particular act amalgamates, codifies and consolidates the law relating to the regulations of practice by advocates and the system of legal profession. This particular act extends to the whole of India. The act has been in force in entire India, and it brought the revolutionary changes in the legal profession in India. It was set out to achieve the utility and the dignity of the profession of law on an all India basis. And the particular preamble of this particular act says that the act amends as well as consolidates the law relating to legal practitioners. This particular Advocate Act of 1961 repeals the Indian Bar Council Act of 1961 and all other laws on the subject. The Advocate Act 61 provides for an autonomous Bar Council in each state and all India Bar Council, consisting mainly of the representative of the state Bar Councils. This particular Advocate Act of 1961 amended many times to bring changes with the changing times and to solve the practical problems. So consequently, here we can say that this particular Advocate Act is a comprehensive legislation standardizing all the provisions for the benefit of legal practitioners, and the fundamental highlight of the act is conferring the Bar Council of India as the highest legalized authority to control the legal vocation. The act maintains the proficient standard by legal practitioners all over the country. And in the end, here I conclude my discussion on the history of legal profession in India. I hope this topic is clear to all of you. Thank you.